you want to go.
It may look like I'm having far too much fun to be working, but I really am on assignment for End Zone Focus. I'm here at Helensville, north of Auckland, to talk to Kerrin and Genevieve Revel about their epic year-long charity ride. To raise funds for youth cancer organization Canteen, this couple and their cavalry of horses jingled collection buckets around the whole of New Zealand, from Cape Reinga to the Bluff and all the way back up again, on their honeymoon.
So a nice sightseeing horse trek around the country. It sounds very romantic, but it's not the most conventional honeymoon, is it?
I think Kerrin was just trying to impress me, actually.
I was. It was meant to be a joke and just sort of, you know, to get her to realise I was interested in her, and then before I knew it, I was on the back of a horse and riding around New Zealand.
It was funny because it was originally, my idea was just to go around the South Island, and then Kerrin came up with the idea of doing the North Island as well and making a documentary.
And you committed to this, like a whole year of trekking around New Zealand, right at the very start of your married lives. Was that a little daunting?
Not really. Well, yes and no. I think we took every day as it came. You know, that's all you can do. There were so many ups and downs and so much stuff happened that, you know, we didn't really have a spare moment to think about what we'd actually got ourselves in for, I think.
Kerrin, by your own admission, you're not exactly a born horseman. So what was it like trying to learn how to ride a horse?
Well, I was thrown right in the deep end. I was chucked on the back of a horse and I was told, this is how you make him go, this is how you make him stop, and yeah, have fun. And so basically Jenna taught me nothing, and my horse Charlie taught me everything.
You write about the horses as though they were people. Is that really how you felt about them, each with their own different personalities?
Well, I call Jenna's horse the loose cannon. Her name's actually Zena. It's a tongue-in-cheek one, really, just because she can have little mood swings against the others, but that's only because she's the dominant mare, basically.
She's a typical female.
Yeah, basically.
She gets PMT.
We've got Falcor, who's a lovely big white Clydesdale cross. He's basically just completely bomb-proof. There's Chocolate, who's a lovely little mare, but she doesn't know how to walk up or down hills, so that makes it quite difficult for Jenna to ride her. I'm too big to ride her. That leaves Charlie T. So we've got two Charlies, and Charlie T's a Palomino, and he's very young and cheeky and inquisitive, just like a little kid, basically.
Now, you decided to fundraise for Canteen. What made you choose that particular charity?
Well, mainly we chose Canteen because of the age group they support, because we both sort of understand how difficult it can be in that age group, and because they're supporting 13 to 24-year-olds that are living with cancer. And I'd personally gone through a rough patch in my teen years without anything like cancer to deal with, so they really gave the inspiration when I was going through that, just seeing that they had way more to deal with and they were coping because they had each other and they had the support network. And yeah, we really believe in the cause and we really thought it was a great thing to raise money for. And we ended up raising $33,000 because we'd let people know that we were coming beforehand. And people were amazing, like we'd ride through the town on the horses and people would be like, hey, you know, we heard about you, and you know, they'd donate to the cause. And we also, on our rest days, would go back to the towns and fundraise on the streets.
And lots of schools gave donations as well, because we visited lots and lots of schools and helped to spread the word of Canteen and also let the kids meet the horses. We've also given a percentage of whatever the book sales are. Canteen will get a percentage of that as well.
And as you trekked around the country, you met quite a few of those Canteen members.
Yeah,
and we actually had a Canteen member, Sam, who rode with us through Dunedin as well. So that was really cool to actually have some Canteeners involved in the actual trek as well. And they're what really helped us when the times were down as well, because we thought, well, you know, Canteen members just can't give up and say, oh, this is getting too hard. And so, you know, there was no way we could quit at all. So they became our inspiration right from day one.
You've met quite a few people on your journey who pitched in to help. Could you tell us about some of those quirky characters?
Oh yes, we had a guy called Uncle, and we met him right at the start. We still don't really know his name. He's just Uncle. That's how he introduced himself. And he would phone us up pretty much every week and be like, hey, how are you doing? And he really helped us out. And the reason we met him was because he just randomly showed up on 90 Mile Beach and unloaded all this hot food from the back of his ute and said, here you go, you know, there's a fully cooked meal. And we didn't even know who he was. It was just awesome.
He basically became our guardian angel in a way.
The trek wasn't exactly a walk in the park. There were some dangerous moments right from the beginning. Could you tell us about some of those?
I guess every day had its own separate dangers, like traffic and cars and buses going far too close to us. And for me, I don't like heights either. So whenever we had to go near a cliff, I wasn't very happy. And I got bucked off at one point and I broke my finger and I cracked about three or four ribs as well. So there were dangers, but I guess we just didn't really think about it that much. And I think if we'd thought about it too much, we wouldn't have done it.
Whoa, tane, mate.
You kind of took the good with the bad, and it was more good than bad, so... And the bad stuff is what makes the book and the doco so good and the trek worthwhile in a way, because those are the bits that we remember.
And what were the highlights of the whole trek for you?
The real highlight was just how people reacted to us, you know, because we had to find somewhere to stay every night, and people would just put us up, and there were people showing up on horses as well and saying, hey, come this way, you can come through our farm. And, you know, most of the time we had someone helping us.
And you, Kerrin?
For me, well, probably going through Christchurch because I have a daughter there. And, so we got to ride right up to her bedroom window and got to visit her at the school with the horses as well. So that was an incredibly special moment for me.
It was just incredible to realise how generous Kiwis really are. If anything went wrong, there was always someone right there to, you know, pitch in, and yeah, it's amazing.
Kerrin, at one point of the trek, Jenna, perhaps unwisely, challenged you to come up with your next adventure. Now, what was that?
Well, I thought, seeing as I didn't know anything about horses on this one, the next adventure should be something that we're both just thrown in the deep end of. And so I decided that we'd go across Australia on camels. We don't really like the idea of spiders and snakes, so it should be interesting.
Okay, that sounds awesome. Thank you both so much for your time.
Cheers.
It's awesome, thanks.